Good morning, dear students. Today, we are going to look into class 10 poem, Not Marble, Nor the Gilded Monument, by William Shakespeare. This is the 55th sonnet written by William Shakespeare out of the 154 sonnets written by him. Students, look into your book and listen to the recitation of the poem, Not Marble, Nor the Gilded Monument, of princes shall outlive this powerful rhyme, but you shall shine more bright in these contents than unswept stone besmeared with sluttish time. When wasteful war shall statues overturn and broils root out the work of masonry, nor Mars's sword nor war's quick fire shall burn the living record of your memory. Against death and all oblivious enmity shall you pace forth. Your praise shall still find room, even in the eyes of all posterity, that wear this world out to the ending doom. So, till the judgment that yourself arise, you live in this and dwell in the lover's eyes. Dear students, do you remember the poem, The Seven Ages, written by William Shakespeare in class 9? Yes, today we are going to learn a little more about William Shakespeare through his sonnet, Not Marble, Nor Gilded Monument. William Shakespeare was an English poet, playwright and actor. He was born on 26th April 1564 in Stratford-upon-Avon. Shakespeare is widely regarded as the greatest writer in the English language and the world's preeminent dramatist. He's often called England's national poet and nicknamed the Bard of Avon. He wrote about 38 plays, 154 sonnets, two long narrative poems, and a few other verses, of which the authorship of some is uncertain. His plays have been translated into every major living language and are performed more often than those of any other playwright. Dear children, do you remember last year we celebrated the 400th year of death anniversary of William Shakespeare? In our school, students played skits during the assembly program. They created the best quotes of Shakespeare and even prepared charts. And that's how we still remember William Shakespeare. His works are eternal. This is the second poem that you are going to learn in your school life of Shakespeare, William Shakespeare. The Julius Caesar, which is the masterpiece of William Shakespeare, you will be learning in the near future, in the days to come. There are 10 of greatest English plays which is recommended to all the students. He is no doubt the greatest writer of modern English today. His plays have been made into movies. His sonnets have appeared in books and music. And his works translated into hundreds of different languages. His contribution to the English language is probably larger than that of anyone else. The top 10 English plays of William Shakespeare goes thus: Othello, The Taming of the Shrew, Twelfth Night, Julius Caesar, which you will be reading in the next few months, Richard the Three, Macbeth, Midsummer Night's Dream, Henry the Five, Romeo and Juliet, and finally the Hamlet. There are different forms of writing in poetry. As I have already told you, elegy, ode, sonnet, lyric, epic, all these are forms of writing. Today we are going to talk about sonnet. What is a sonnet? We will see later. But about this sonnet, we are going to see. Sonnet 55 is one of Shakespeare's most famous sonnets. He is simply saying that the poem he is writing to some unnamed person will last longer than marble, gravestones, stone monuments decorated with gold, dedicated to departed royalty. And the individual being addressed in the sonnet will live longer in the human memory because he is enshrined in the poem. This turned out to be the simple truth. because Shakespeare's sonnet is still being read after 400 years, while few marble gravestones, marble markers, or gilded monuments have remained in existence for that long, having been overturned, uprooted, or destroyed by wars. And it would appear that at least some of his sonnets, including the numbered 55, will be read for many hundred years to come. Now, let's look at the central theme of the poem. The poet says that all monuments and marbles will definitely be brought to dust. These things are not eternal or perennial. Everything has an end. Instead, his verse, his poetry, will be everlasting by the reader. The poet reveals the stark reality that everything comes to an end gradually by the impact of time. Nothing in this world is permanent. Everything is momentary. Everything has an end, except the literary composition. These verses are everlasting and eternal. Time brings everything to an end. Time is supreme. However, the poem acknowledges the durability of the written word in comparison to other structures like marble or golded plated structures. These marble and golded plated structures definitely will have an end. Whereas the written word or the poem or the verses definitely can stand the test of time. He feels that a literary composition like a poem can touch the hearts of many and can withstand the corrosive impact of time. Nothing can erode the literary composition. The poet contrasts the power of poetry with that of monuments built by princes and kings. He wants to bring out the powerful impact of poetry on readers in comparison to the monuments built by princes and kings. Wars can destroy the monuments, but even the god of war cannot burn the impact of written words. The poet advises the person he loves to move forward, forgetting all fears and enmity. This will remain him alive in the minds of future generations. This is the best way to live in peace till the world comes to an end. He has written about his friend, and his friend will live forever through the verses which will be read by the people of future generation, which can never have an end at all. This is the central theme of the poem. When we talk about the structure of the poem, the poet has used a sonnet as a structure. The word sonnet is derived from the Italian word sonetto. It means a small or a little song or lyric. In poetry, a sonnet has 14 lines and is written in iambic pentameter. Each line has 10 syllables. Shakespeare's sonnets is the title of a collection of 154 sonnets by William Shakespeare, which covers themes such as passage of time, love, beauty, and mortality. The first 26 sonnets are addressed to a young man, the last 28 to a woman. The two predominant poetic devices or literary devices used in this poem are alliteration and imagery. What is an alliteration? The repetition of consonants at the beginning of two or more words immediately succeeding each other or at short intervals are called alliteration. We have seen the usage of alliteration in the previous poems also. Here, shall shine. You can see S and S being repeated. Wasteful was. So you can find out a few more alliterations from the reader. Now, what is an imagery? When words are used to conjure up pictures, that usage is called imagery. The examples of imagery are thus: but you shall shine more bright in these contexts than unswept stone besmeared with sluttish time. Going to the tone of the poem, we have seen in the class 9, "Oh, I wish I have looked after my teeth." There was a regretful tone. Now, what is this tone of the poem? The tone of this poem is of great confidence and hope. The speaker is confidently pronouncing how the object of his affection will outlive all the marble, the gilded monuments of princes, and shall shine more bright than unswept stone besmeared with sluttish time, or any other works of masonry created to honor and commemorate great figures of the past. You can see that he is having a lot of confidence that his verse, the poetic composition in which he has commemorated his friend, is going to outlive generation and will stand the test of time in the present and in the future years to come. You may wonder why I am concluding with this particular picture titled Ozymandias. Ozymandias is a poem written by P.B. Shelley. This is going to be a next poem. This is a straight contrast with the poem that you have learned just now. Here in Ozymandias, the poet says, "Time can bring everything to dust." Thank you.